Good morning and welcome to Malvern Baptist Church. This morning we'll be sharing communion together. So if you'd like to go and get some bread and wine and pause the video for a moment, then we'll be prepared for the Lord's table a little later on. Psalm 30 says this: I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord, my God, I called to you for help and you healed me. Lord, you brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing the praises of the Lord. You, his faithful people, praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favour lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. We're going to sing a song together now about a precious truth. What a friend we have in Jesus. Bible reading is taken from Romans chapter 8. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it. In hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay, and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth, right up to this present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope in for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified, and those he justified, he also glorified. Let us sing again how deep the Father's love for us. Pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing again, I cast my mind to Calvary.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled. Body bound and drenched in tears.
to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Listen, I'm standing at the door, knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into you and eat with you and you with me. Paul says, God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And Jesus says this in Matthew, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to this table, not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. Let us remember now that Christ Jesus' blood was shed for us and his body was broken for us on the cross. Let's confess our sins to Almighty God. Lord, we say that we are sorry for the wrong that we have done. We say that we are sorry for the things that we should have done and haven't done. We're sorry for the failings in our lives. Sorry for the ways in which we have not loved you as you're worthy to be worshipped. And we fail to love our fellow brothers and sisters. Forgive us, Lord, we pray. Amen. So remember on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this whenever you eat it, to remember me. Let us eat together the body of Christ. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He said, this is the blood of the new covenant shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, to remember me. Let's drink together, remembering the shed blood of Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to die upon the cross for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you came. You descended from heaven and lived among us and showed us how to live. But also, Lord, you died for us that our sins may be forgiven and we might have fellowship with God. And we thank you for sending your Holy Spirit to live in us and empower us. Amen. Let's now come to our Old Testament reading taken from the book of Genesis 39, and we continue our sermon series in the book of Genesis, looking at the life of Joseph. Let's pray. Lord, speak to us now as we hear your words. Lord, in this ancient story, Lord, we pray that you would speak into our lives here and now. Amen. Genesis 39, verses 1 to 23. Now, Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. The Lord was with Joseph now that he prospered. And he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him a success in everything he did, Joseph found favour in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household and entrusted to his care everything he owned. From the time he put him in charge of his household and of all that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both in the house and in the field. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Now Joseph was well built and handsome. And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, "Come to bed with me." But he refused. With me in charge, he told her, "My master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns is entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God?" And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her or even be with her. One day he went into the house to attend to his duties, and none of the household servants was inside. She caught him by his cloak and said, "Come to bed with me." But he left his cloak in her hand and ran out of the house. When she saw that he had left his cloak in her hand and had run out of the house, she called her household servants. "Look," she said to them, "this Hebrew has been brought here to make sport of us. He came in here to sleep with me, but I screamed. When he heard me scream for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house." She kept his cloak beside her until his master came home. Then she told him this story. "That Hebrew slave you brought us came to me to make sport of me. But as soon as I screamed for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house." When his master heard the story, his wife told him, saying, "This is how your slave treated me. He burned with anger." Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was there in the prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favour in the eyes of the prison warder. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in the prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. Viktor Frankl, an Austrian Jew who survived torture in a Nazi prison camp, said this: "The last of all great freedoms is to choose one's response to any given set of circumstances." We're not told how Joseph felt about being beaten up by his brothers and thrown into a cistern without water. Nor are we told how he felt about being dragged out again and being sold to a bunch of Ishmaelite traders who carted him off to the slave markets of Egypt. But we can guess that as a 17-year-old spoiled rich kid, it was a bit of a culture shock to him. But what we learn from the passage we've just heard is that Joseph, over time, refused to let himself become a victim of those circumstances. Joseph's brothers had initially decided to kill him, but when they saw the Ishmaelite traders, they took the opportunity to make a quick buck and sold him. They then took Joseph's torn and bloodied coat of many colours back to his father Jacob. That was Joseph's father, and spun him a cruel yarn that Joseph had been killed by a wild animal. Meanwhile, in Egypt, Joseph had been purchased by Potiphar, the captain of Pharaoh's guards. Potiphar was a highly trusted royal official, a effectively the head of imperial security. And we learn that Potiphar had a house with lands and a state. We assume he was a wealthy man in one of the world's leading civilizations of the time. And we can legitimately read into this passage that Joseph didn't become bitter or rebellious about his unjust slavery, but knuckled down to do his work and found favour in the sight of the master. We also know that Joseph found favour with God. It says the Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. He didn't live in the slave quarters, he lived up in the posh house. I think we can also read into this passage that Joseph had a relationship with the Lord God, and that somehow Joseph gave witness to that in his life and work. It says in verse 3, his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did. Potiphar noticed that the God of Israel had gifted Joseph with extraordinary administrative abilities, and that this same God was blessing the work that Joseph was carrying out. And therefore Potiphar was happy to promote him to be his estate manager and trust him completely in its operation. As one who has worked for a number of bosses, I can say from personal experience that it can be a pain to have one who insists on micromanaging you. There are a couple of things I think we can learn from this part of Joseph's story. First is that we can witness to God through our attitude to our work, be that paid work, unpaid work, or voluntary work. It says in the book of Ephesians, slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favour when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. And it says in the book of 1 Peter 2, live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Obviously we're not slaves at the moment, but I think this also applies to those we work for. Secondly, witness to God through our attitude to our present circumstances. Joseph found himself in a difficult situation with no obvious way out, but did his best to serve God in that situation without complaining, and that attitude was noticed. What's our attitude to our current situation, especially the COVID-19 situation? Are we seeking to cheerfully serve God, giving thanks for his blessings? Or are we moaning about a loss of freedoms, loss of holidays? And what is that saying to those around us? Paul says in Philippians 2, do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold out the word of life. And thirdly, God blesses obedience. God blessed Joseph's attitude and diligence with advancement in Potiphar's household. He didn't stay mucking out the stables or chopping firewood for long. And also God blessed Potiphar and his household too. You see, in the general run of things, we can expect God to bless our lives when we are obedient to him, and bless the department or the company or the charity we work for or the family that we're in. Jeremiah 30:29 says, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Generally, we can expect blessings if we bless the Lord. Having said what I've said, that generally God blesses obedience, sometimes God has a higher purpose for our lives than simple prosperity, as the life of Joseph goes on to prove. You see, things are going pretty well for Joseph, but then he runs up against the original desperate housewife, Potiphar's wife. She notices that Joseph is pretty fit and offers him sex on a plate. She says, come to bed with me. And we mustn't minimise the extent of the temptation here. Joseph was a virile young man. As a foreign slave, he would have had little or no outlet for his sexual urges. But he does exactly the right thing. He refuses her advances. He says, with me in charge, my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he has entrusted to my care. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? But she nags him day after day, and he persistently resists. You see, Joseph is determined to do the right thing. He recognises where he is vulnerable, and so he refuses to be alone with Potiphar's wife. But reading between the lines, she probably organises it so that she and Joseph are alone in the house. And then she strikes. She grabs his garment, probably a short linen kilt, and he runs for it, leaving the garment in her hand. Congreve said, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. And scorned by a slave, Potiphar's wife accuses Joseph of sexual assault. Potiphar becomes enraged and throws Joseph into prison. You see, if we seek to grow in our relationship with God, if we seek to serve him, we will be tempted and tested, and we need to learn how to resist temptation. If we yield to temptation, we sin, and our resolve not to sin is further weakened. And if we succumb to repeated sin, and that becomes a habit, that then becomes a stronghold. And sin can have serious consequences. It can lead firstly to diversion. Satan tempted Jesus in the wilderness and later in Gethsemane in an attempt to divert him away from his life's mission to go to the cross and for the salvation of the world. And then to destruction. Paul says in 1 Timothy 6, those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. However, we need to remember, it says in Hebrews 4, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathise with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. We need to remember that about Jesus. Jesus was tempted in every way that we're tempted, just that he failed to succumb. It says in 1 John 1, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Whatever our sin, we can come to God with that sin and know his forgiveness. And it says in Micah 7, verse 8, do not gloat over me, my enemy, though I have fallen, I will rise. We need to remember those positive things. And we have God-given tactics for resisting temptation. Firstly, we must know and rely upon the word of God. Jesus, when resisting temptation in the wilderness, said three times, it is written, and he quoted the Old Testament back at Satan. Secondly, we must watch and pray. Jesus said to his disciples in Gethsemane, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Thirdly, we mustn't give Satan an opportunity to open or an opening in our lives. Paul says in Ephesians 4, do not give the devil a foothold. In the Second World War, it was vitally important for the Allied forces to gain a bridgehead on the beaches at Normandy if they were to know victory at D-Day. The most vulnerable time was when they were invading the beaches and when the Germans could have pushed them back into the sea. Once they'd established a sizeable bridgehead, it was almost inevitable that there would be victory in Europe. We must not give the devil a bridgehead into our lives. Then we can flee temptation. Joseph firstly resolved not to put himself in the way of temptation. by refusing to be alone with Mrs. Potiphar. Secondly, when she made a grab for him, he fled. There's an old Chinese proverb that says, you can't stop the birds flying overhead, but you can stop them nesting in your hair. You can't stop tempting thoughts, but you can decide whether you linger on them or develop them. Then we should submit to God and resist the devil, it says in James 4. Joseph resisted Potiphar's wife and rebuked her. And then we can focus on good thoughts. It says in Philippians 4, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. You know, if we're thinking good thoughts, positive thoughts, pure thoughts, right thoughts, if we've got something useful to do, then we're less likely to focus on the negative stuff. And then we can also get a spiritual partner and become accountable to them and encourage one another. It says in the book of Ecclesiastes 4, two are better than one because they have a good return for their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. So there are some strategies there for help in temptation. But then the story continues. Despite doing the right thing, occupying the moral high ground, Joseph finds himself the victim of injustice. He goes from pit to prison. But instead of becoming bitter or depressed, he continues to trust God and do his best to use his God-given talents, even behind bars. I guess in prison, the prisoners had duties, and this was Pharaoh's prison, where the political prisoners ended up. It wasn't just a hole for Egypt's lowlifes. The warder recognized Joseph's management abilities and put him in charge of the prison task, very much as Potiphar had done. And it says the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warder. Sometimes life just doesn't work out the way that we plan it. Strict karma does not always apply. And we who are mature need to realize that sometimes God has a better plan for our lives than is immediately obvious at the time. And we need to exercise patient humility and deep trust in the providence of God. It says in James 4. Now listen, you who say today or tomorrow we'll go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. You know, there's a warning there that we can't presume to have a prosperous tomorrow. God sometimes has other plans for our life. And on the positive side, we need to hold on to the promise in Scripture, which I guess many of us have memorized, from Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. This is one of the foremost lessons of Joseph's life, and also that of Jesus' life. And Joseph is probably the leading type of Jesus in the Old Testament. You know what I mean by type? A person who is an example of God's servant who prefigures Jesus. You see, Joseph is the favored son of the Father, the child of destiny. And he descends from his favored position to the pit. He's rejected by Israel in the form of his brothers, the heads of the tribes of Israel. And like Jesus, he lives an upright life and gains favour with men, yet through treachery is unjustly punished at the hands of the establishment. Throughout this, he refuses to become bitter or take the easy way out. So I urge you, as we travel through the story of Joseph in the next few weeks, to see the story of Jesus foreshadowed. And also, as disciples of Jesus, realize that we are called to follow him through challenging and testing times, remaining true to our calling, just as Joseph and Jesus did. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the example of Joseph. We pray that like Joseph, we might be able to resist temptation and live moral and upright lives, witnessing to those who live and work around us. Grant us all, Lord, an insight into, Lord, your sovereignty in our lives, keeping us trusting in you. Amen. Let us sing our last song together. Stand up, stand up. Closing prayer says this. For your goodness and generosity in giving us all we need, help us praise you, O God. In every circumstance of life, in good times and bad, help us trust you, O God. In love and faithfulness with all that we have and all that we are, help us serve you, O God. As we speak or write or listen to those nearby or far away, help us share your love, O God. In our plans and work for ourselves and for others, help us glorify you, O God. In every thought and word and deed, by the power of your Holy Spirit this week, may we live for you, O God.